So, let's say you're at the start of a game development cycle. You're currently working out the concept, you're trying to narrow down all the specifications, maybe the narrative, get the setting, and get the overall game feel, but you're having some trouble doing that. The ideas that you or your team are coming up with are kind of all over the place, and often they don't form into a coherent game idea that you could then follow on through with. Well, something that could potentially help you right now would be some set of rules or perhaps guidelines that could help you and your team narrow their vision and focus more into a specific aspect or part of the experience spectrum that you want to evoke for your player and, by extension, for your game. Now, most commonly, what you would use in this scenario is something that is referred to as the design pillars, or the pillars on which the fundamentals of your project stand. Now, in this video, I'm going to be briefly explaining what exactly these design pillars are, what is their use, how you should set them, what not to do when setting them, and when the time comes, why and how you should revisit them throughout the development cycle. Anyways, with that out of the way, get your pen and paper ready, prepare to throw out some concepts, and let's go. So first of all, as already mentioned, design pillars are a set of rules or guidelines that on a certain amount of high level define what direction your game is going to go in. Of course, if you just start your concepting phase with wanting to make a fun game, the limitations on what you could do are basically infinite, and while this might sound like a great idea at first, what you'll soon find out is that it will be very difficult to get a coherent and narrowed vision of the game that the whole team could agree on, rather than just having several ideas kind of floating in midair with no real underlying theme or cohesion. Design pillars will act as a set of guidelines that will be set probably by your team, even though some of them can come from the publisher directly, and will give the entire project a more steered vision, and hopefully, for the team, a better idea of what the game is that they're going to be developing. Now, where these come from can kind of vary. In most situations, they describe dynamics on a high level. They can also describe groups of dynamics. However, they're not limited to them. Sometimes they can get as specific as smaller groups of mechanics, and sometimes they can be as broad as restrictions set by the publisher, or perhaps the target audience or platform that you're developing for. I think as a good example, in a 2017 blog post by Max Pierce, he took apart The Last of Us and decided to divide it into four design pillars, which I think was actually done exceptionally well. According to him, The Last of Us as a game stands on four core design pillars, and these would be crafting, story, AI partners, and stealth. Now, why I think this works really well is that if you tried to break apart what Last of Us is as a game, you would most likely end up with some subset of these four core words. Because if we take apart the gameplay and narrative, then the gameplay is essentially boiled down to crafting and stealth combat. Of course, with the added possibility of non-stealth combat, but like I said, we're not breaking it into mechanics. And the narrative would break down into the story and the AI partners through which you often experience that story. To get more specific, if we break apart the AI partners one, they say that the game is all about building a relationship between the player's character and the AI partner Ellie, and other partners you meet throughout your journey. Now, of course, if this is earlier in development, you wouldn't necessarily know that the AI partner is going to be Ellie. You might not even know if it's going to be one or multiple. So the design pillar then would probably sound something like, the game is all about building a relationship between the player's character with AI partners that you meet throughout your journey. And while this doesn't necessarily limit you to a single mechanic direction that you have to go, it does greatly restrict your full-on creative infinite vision into a game that is probably gonna have some very strong characters that you will be building your relationship with. And when it comes to restricting the creative vision, that is only one of the uses that design pillars can have for you throughout the entire development cycle. Of course, at the start, you want to narrow down on what kind of game you're going to create, and establishing your design pillars is a fantastic way of doing it. From these onwards, your concepting will get a lot more focused, and you can try establishing a lot more coherent and reasonable game ideas for the concept. At the same time, these can always be revisited throughout the development cycle to check whether the game is still adhering to the original vision. Now, something like this would probably be mostly done by the director, the producer, or the creative director, who can, simply based on the set of rules, at any point check if the game development is going in the right direction, which, you might be surprised, if it's a multi-year project, can steer pretty far away from the original idea unless consistently checked and corrected. But okay, now we understand what design pillars are and what their use is, so how do you set them for your own project? Now, besides what I've already mentioned, as in basing them on larger chunks of your gameplay, if you do not have that yet, work off of two main things. First of all, if you're working for a publisher, chances are you're going to have some sort of a brief, which already limits you greatly in what kind of a game they want you to create. From this brief, you can apply a bit of additional research, expand on it a little bit yourself, and already start giving yourself a solid idea of what the game is going to be. Now, if you happen to not have a brief, the best recommendation is to simply base these on your research. You and your team should spend the time looking into what works and what doesn't work in the gaming industry, which of these things you can achieve with your team's skills and qualifications, and which things should rather be dropped. Once you have established this solid knowledge base, let's call it, off of that you can start building and solidifying what kind of a game you would like to create and what type of design pillars the game would have to stand on. Now, if you're in the process of already establishing these, there are a few things that you should be aware of and wary of in order for you to not actually make your life more difficult than it was before the establishing of these. And that is, first of all, do not make too many of these. If you find yourself having 10, 15, 20, or even possibly more design pillars, chances are you're going way too specific with them, and running the strong risk of restricting yourself far too much. And while yes, your team will have a great idea of what game you want to create, there might be a better game waiting right around the corner that you could build if you just allowed a little bit of extra creative wiggle room. On the same note, if you find yourself having too few, only one or two, it doesn't necessarily have to be bad depending on the game that you're making. However, chances are you might want to be a bit more specific to make sure that if you guys are trying to develop a VR platforming game, you don't end up making a mobile MMO. And on that same note, make sure that the entirety of your team is clear on these and understands what every single one of them means. Having them as single word phrases is totally fine, but do make sure there is a document where each of these is expanded on, at least in a short description, so that even people who might not have directly been involved with creating these can get a general idea of what the game is going to be like simply based on the descriptions. But now, your game is in full development, your design pillars have been established, you put them on the shelf, and the big mistake that some people make is that they never ever revisit them. They see them as a thing that you establish at the start, and that's it, it's done. However, the true value often comes in when you have to make creative decisions later down the line in the development process, and you're not sure which way is more in line with the original vision of the game that you had. This would be the perfect opportunity to climb back to the shelf where you put the document, take it out and look at the original set of rules that you set for yourself and simply compare which of those is more in line with what you wanted to create at the start of the project. As I already mentioned, these things can deviate a crazy amount if you spend a long time working on a game without ever looking back on the entirety of what you've actually created. So make sure to at least every once in a while have the director or the creative director go over these just to confirm that you're still developing that game that you set out to develop at the start of the project. Anyways, that is all I had to say about the design pillars. I hope you guys found this video interesting and learned at least something new that you could potentially apply to any project that you're working on. If you did, or if you think there's something that I didn't say, or a good experience you've had with setting design pillars that could potentially help other people who might be struggling with this, please make sure to leave it down in the comments below. I would also love to read it and maybe apply it to any next project that I'm working on. If you like the video, maybe consider leaving a like, commenting, subscribing, or checking out other videos I have in the video game design playlist. With that, I want to wish you all a beautiful rest of the day, and I'm going to see you in whatever next video I make. Bye bye.